Welcome back to the Hearthstone Championship Tour Europe Winter Preliminaries. I'm Robert Werthewing, back on the desk, joined by Team Liquid Savij, and once again, Brian Kibler of Brian Kibler Gaming. And we are all the way to the round of 32. It's already been an exciting, action-packed day. A day of upsets, as Frodan called it. Completely inclined to agree. What do you guys think of the day so far?
Well, a lot of upsets, like you said. The European champion getting knocked down to lower bracket. The world champion getting knocked down to lower bracket. Nobody expected that.
Yeah, I know. If you would have told me the standing so far, I'd have been very surprised. Ty's already completely eliminated. Definitely someone I had expected to go a lot farther. Osaka in the lower bracket. So luckily, you know, there still are some big names left. And I think more importantly, you know, a lot of players who, you know, are saying they are that good, they can beat these players. They're rising to the occasion. And now, you know, we're to the round of 32. And we saw, obviously, before the break, the player who's playing right now is Casper. That's his name. The collection of letters and numbers was too spooky for us. So we're going to go ahead and use Casper. Maybe that wasn't the best logic behind that, but yeah, he will be taking on Gaara, who is another kind of well-known pillar of Hearthstone going back to way back in the day. Member of Tempo Storm, prolific shaman player, but he's going to have his work cut out for him.
No Brian, shaman, though. No shaman, sadly.
Prolific shaman player with exactly zero shaman in his lineup. We see his druid has been banned out by Casper, and it looks like Casper has chosen to... No, Casper has chosen to ban druid, and Gaara has chosen to ban mage, from what we can tell, so... kind of an interesting choice there. It might be Warlock. Hard to see at the moment. But so Casper banning out Druid. Obviously, this is a very popular ban. Druid has a lot of power, as we've seen today. The ability to really quickly accelerate the mana curve, play out these big, obnoxious creatures. And of course, the finisher of Savage Aura, Force of Nature. I like it as a ban. I think if I was coming into this tournament, I would totally do that.
Yeah, I think that this bans actually kind of favor Gaara, because his druid did end up getting banned, so getting rid of that mage, the mage could have been a huge problem if it's a freeze mage and he wouldn't have access to his druid.
If that is a freeze mage, it's definitely a druid being banned. It makes a lot of sense from the other player because, well, you want to protect your freeze mage, but if you're in Gaara's shoes, you might expect your druid will get banned, and then you want to ensure that there's no freeze mage that you have to play against.
Yeah. Gaara is a very well-known professional player for like 2 years already, and he's also known for his wacky deck building, so we might be seeing some cool stuff from Gaara. I wouldn't be surprised to see something out of the box.
Yeah, definitely. Gaara is a player who, like I said, in the very beginning of his career kind of made his name playing Shaman really well, but as you said, in tournaments he's been in since, he always kind of brings these wacky, if not not like wacky tech cards, he oftentimes plays classes that are perceived as weaker. I know Gaara was for a time playing Priest in a period where Priest was not very well thought of prior to League of Explorers, where they got Museum Curator and Entomb, so definitely expecting a lot from Gaara, and it might just be that that kind of like unique style he has is what has kind of helped him get this far, because I think for a lot of these players, maybe the lineups are a little bit predictable.
Well, it's interesting because since the release of League of Explorers, one of the classes that has been perceived as among the weakest is actually Hunter. You haven't seen nearly as many Hunters. It was, for a long time, one of the most popular classes in the tournament scene, but we actually just saw that Hunter deck take down Osaka last round, and here Gaara is with a Hunter as well.
Yeah, it's Conquest format, and Gaara has made it this far with his Hunter, so it did work in the previous matches.
I mean, there's certainly a school of thought that if you bring something that you don't expect your opponents to expect, that maybe it's stronger because of that surprise element. And, you know, Hunter a little bit weaker since League of Explorers because there is so much healing in the meta. It's still not necessarily a bad deck. You can certainly surprise people with it. You can play that Face Hunter variant. You can play hybrid mid-range Hunters, even made kind of a resurgence on the ladder. But we're going to see Gaara go ahead and open up here with Warlock against Casper's Paladin deck. And we see the secret from Casper, obviously says that that's going to be a secret Paladin deck. And then we see Gaara looks to be playing Warlock Zoo.
Yeah, we mostly talk about Gaara because he's the player that we know better out of these two. But I actually played against Casper online on the European ladder quite a few times, and this guy is a real like active player. He's played a lot. He plays a lot. He's not just somebody who got lucky and got a few points here and there and just trying it out. But he's a very experienced and strong player.
Oh, and definitely to make it to the round of 32, as stacked as these preliminaries were, with as many big names as we saw, I mean, that's not a flash in the pan. That's someone who's clearly very competent in Hearthstone and knows what they're doing. That said, Casper's opening hand for a Secret Paladin, thus far, it's going to need a little bit of work. We see two secrets in the opening hand, especially Competitive Spirit is not something you want earlier. That Knife Juggler is great, and Divine Favor against Zoo could go either way, but it's definitely not something you want in the opening.
Yeah, Divine Favor is a card that it's fantastic against the more controlling versions of Warlock. If you're playing as Reno Lock, Hand Lock, one of the combo style of Warlock decks, it's great. Not usually as good against an opponent who plays Abusive Sergeant on turn one.
Yeah, the Divine Favor works so well against the Warlock hero power, but with the type of Warlock that Gaara is running, he's not going to be tapping all that much.
right? And we see Garra does just jam down that Abusive Sergeant. Obviously, it's better played when you're using it on a minion to buff them up to look to do a specific trade or even just do a lot of damage to the face. But he feels he has to get something out on the board, which against Paladin is very, very smart, as you tend to see kind of that coin-shielded mini-bot. You could see the Secret Keeper come out.
An interesting decision we actually just saw from Garra. He chose not to attack with an Abusive Sergeant on the second turn. He's respecting the possibility that Secret is Noble Sacrifice. I'm sure there's some, you know, Smork miss two damage going on right now, but that's, you know, a pretty heads-up play because he is playing a Haunted Creeper, which can attack very well into a potential Noble Sacrifice, especially when there is a Knife Juggler involved, and they'd be able to throw some knives from the Spider Dying. We know that the Secret is, in fact, Venge, so Garra did, in fact, miss two damage, but that's the rationale behind that kind of play.
Right. This is an interesting decision for Garra, because the Knife Juggler is pretty tempting to get out fast, but if he played the Dark Peddler, he would still have that one extra mana to potentially cast the one mana minion that he gets from the Peddler.
It's also worth noting that the Juggler does get better when you have the opportunity to play additional things the same turn, or that your opponent has minions that you're looking to clear with it. His opponent is going to turn three, which is potentially a muster for battle turn, and Knife Juggler will very likely be able to help remove some of those minions if that's what his opponent does play.
On the other hand, though, like based on the line of play that Garra took with not attacking with the Abusive, he's expecting that there would be a Noble Sacrifice, in which case he would get some free juggles. Oh,
that was interesting.
That's really interesting.
Changed his mind, yeah. I guess. I'm curious. Perhaps he's trying to play around the possibility of a Consecration. So he perhaps chose to attack with the Abusive Sergeant first because he wants to preserve the spiders from the Creeper, whether for protection after Consecration or enabling that Knife Juggler later on.
Right, and this is kind of interesting to me. A lot of times when you're playing against a deck or a player and you don't necessarily know what's in their hand, if they don't really play much early on, you kind of start to wonder what's actually in there. But since you've seen that first Secret from the Paladin, you know this is Secret Paladin. Mm-hmm. And since they haven't played something like a Shielded Minibot or a Muster, it's actually probably just pretty safe to assume they did not get those good cards early on. And they're kind of in a situation where, I mean, we see the Coghammer just coming out completely naked, not giving any buff to any minions. And that is a worst-case scenario for Coghammer. Like, yes, it will allow Casper to deal with the board, but Garra has to be feeling great about how this is going so far.
Yeah, it's a pretty rough hand for Casper right here with those secrets and the Divine Favor to begin with. But on the other hand, Garra also with double Doom cards, and that's not optimal because the second one is likely to get discarded by the first one.
Yeah, it's interesting because now Garra does have the opportunity to potentially use Life Tap and play the Knife Juggler to sort of play more mana efficiently in this turn. But with those two Doom Guards in his hand, the value of tapping kind of goes down a little bit at this stage of the game because, you know, if he does draw into cards that he'd rather preserve, you know, he runs the risk of discarding them as well.
It also played really heavily into Consecration. And since you haven't seen any of these other drops that you expect when playing a Secret Paladin, it's one of those things where you don't want to overplay into that. And in general, Knife Juggler coming down last turn wouldn't have done too much. You would have just played it and tapped, so you wouldn't have gotten too much value out of it. So I like the decision to hold it.
Well, that's going to help with the double Doom Guards.
Yeah, the Void Caller is one turn too late for Garra. He would have loved to play that last turn, particularly with those two Doom Guards. He could have actually had Doom Guard into Doom Guard on turn five.
But it's still pretty good.
It's still nice. It gives him a play that will potentially enable him to get both Doom Guards out without risking discarding the other one. Though this is kind of an awkward spot for him. You know, he doesn't particularly have great trades or attacks this turn. He only really can potentially play that Void Caller, then go three damage to face, and then he is just walking into his opponent having the biggest minion in play with a secret up as well.
Right, and Casper has to be kind of happy that this game hasn't steamrolled out of control, because a lot of times when you play against Zoo, it's very possible to just early in the game you lose board, you never get it back as Secret Paladin.
Whoa, he just chooses not to play the Void Caller in here.
This is interesting, too, because he didn't tap first, so it's not as if as you say, he could have gone for like an Abusive Sergeant tap and then maybe look to do that, but he's still going to get some juggles here, and if the second juggle lands, he can trade it out, so he can trade it out, thankfully, but that was a little bit of a clunky sequence for Garra. I kind of wonder what he's trying to play around right now.
Yeah, that's very interesting. I suddenly did not expect that.
And now, I mean, this is if Casper's looking for it, this is a clean board clear with Consecration. But from Garra's perspective, if your opponent is using their entire turn effectively to cast Consecration and wipe your board at this point, you're not too upset because you get to go into next turn now and play Void Caller Egg potentially. And then, you know, you have the Void Caller along with those Doom Guards to actually keep the pressure on.
Right. Casper doesn't necessarily need to use the Consecration here because he does have the Coghammer, so
it's true.
He can just clear the Juggler with that. The Juggler is one of those things that you just never want to leave up. So if he had the consecrate, he would do it for sure. But that weapon might be enough.
Yeah, well, he has consecration. He could play perhaps the attack into the juggler, play his own juggler, make a Silverhand recruit with his hero power, and then perhaps play a secret.
Yep, that would work. He already has the Avenge up too, so it's not too bad.
It does enable a fairly strong board and does preserve the consecration. It also lets him play multiple cards this turn, which is relevant to possibly get some value out of the Divine Favor later in the game.
Right, and obviously these small minions on the side of Zgara, they don't represent really much damage at all. Really where they start becoming problematic when you're playing against Zoo is minions like Abusive Sergeant, Direwolf Alpha, Defender of Argus, things that can buff up the minions. But Gaara just had to go through a very awkward sequence to clear the Lotheb, so you can probably assume that unless he gets it in this draw, he doesn't have an Abusive Sergeant, so you're probably feeling a little bit safer.
Wow, skipping the attacks again.
So here, Gaara looking to play around the multiple spawn possibility of Noble Sacrifice plus Redemption. Plus there's just the Avenge that he basically knows is
right
up at this point.
Yeah, Gaara is completely aware. It's pretty much written, this is an Avenge.
Yeah.
So, yeah, the decision to play around Noble Sacrifice Avenge, I like it. I think it makes sense. Although at some point, Gaara has to become the aggressor in this matchup, I feel.
It's true that generally speaking, the Zoo deck, and especially we see the Gormok in his hand, that likely means he doesn't have that much more top end. Usually
right.
You don't tend to see Gormok in the same deck as things like Mal'Ganis, though he does have those Void Callers. So those typically do suggest that maybe he does have the bigger demons in his deck as well.
Yeah, personally, I really like the inclusion of Mal'Ganis in case that you are playing those Void Callers, because it's just so powerful against decks with no big game or silence.
Mm-hmm.
Well, silence doesn't really even deal with that, but so powerful against decks without big game. Getting that 9-7 early on is this game winning.
Oh, that is actually a huge draw.
Wow.
That is a big game changer.
That is actually very, very relevant because drawing a one-cost minion allows Gaara to actually play two one-cost minions and then enable his Gormok the Impaler
right.
to get its ability to trigger this turn.
He can also get by a Noble Sacrifice if he believes it's there with the Egg now,
mm-hmm.
with the Abusive Sergeant, as opposed to having to run in the Void Gully.
Unless it hits the Egg, but no, the Juggle does not hit the Egg.
Worst juggler, EU.
That would actually be kind of problematic for Gaara.
And he puts it into the really buffed up Mysterious Challenger who's clearly been working out.
Who am I? Someone who uses my gym membership.
Ah, there's so few of us. right now Gaara's just got a really large board and just kind of seemingly out of nowhere has suddenly developed a board that is really intimidating when last turn it just looked like a little bit on the ropes.
Yeah, I mean, Gaara went two turns basically just not attacking. You know, he actually has been pretty passive, but he took that line of play because it enabled him to get to this point when he was able to develop a very strong board presence. However, Casper does have this second challenger, which will give him a pretty significant board presence of his own.
Yep. All right, we're going to see the competitive spirit played as well. So. Something that I find interesting, Keeper of Uldumon in the hand of Casper, and that's a card that has just given people fits that came out in League of Explorers, but it's really not super useful. What are you going to do, buff up his Abusive Sergeant to a 3-3, make a Gormok a 3-3?
Should be lethal. Getting rid of that the Noble Sacrifice, double Doom
yeah,
Guards to face.
Yeah,
that is
Doom Guards.
20 damage.
That is a lot of damage. And we were just saying, you know, oh, well, he just kind of was playing pretty passively here, but that allowed him to set up one big attack to finish Casper off in pretty much a single turn.
Casper just gives him a nod, like, yeah that is
all
a lot of damage.
Right, I am dead.
That is two Doom Guards coming out on the same turn, which does not happen very frequently.
It is rare. It is a rarity. And no cards were discarded.
Right. Thanks, Voidcaller. What a guy. So, obviously, sequencing lines up perfectly for Gaara in the end.
Mm-hmm.
We thought he was playing a little passively. He had it down the whole time. He knew exactly what he was doing. He's like, I'm just going to play two Doom Guards and win the game.
In that matchup, I think board controlling and just playing it a little
right.
bit carefully is completely fine, as
yeah.
long as you can just keep the Paladin board from snowballing out of control.
Yeah, your only real reach if the board does get to the point where it favors the Paladin is those Doom Guards. So you need to be careful to not allow them to get significant board presence. We saw him very carefully ensure that Lotheb left play on that turn so that Casper never really was able to take the initiative and start attacking back into his board.
Right. Obviously, one of the things is the Paladin probably has the stronger board control game because of stuff like Coghammer, the ability to have Divine Shield, but the Zoo has a little bit more reach in the form of Power Overwhelming, in the form of the Doom Guards, the Abusive Sergeant. So it's one of those things where, as the Zoo player, you kind of realize, like, all right, now's my time to just put out the burst. We're not trying to hold the board anymore. Luckily, Gaara didn't really have to worry about it. He set up that huge board, and then the next turn had the burst, just in the way the Noble Sacrifice panned out, the Void Caller bringing out the Doom Guard. So really well navigated by Gaara.
Yep.
I actually think Casper, for what his opening hand was looking like, pieced together a pretty impressive performance there.
Yeah, that was one of the worst Paladin starting hands I've ever seen. It
really was.
Yeah. So bad.
I mean, his turn two was just make a guy. That's especially against a deck that's going to be putting a lot of pressure on you early, that's never what you want to be doing.
I'm sure if he hadn't played that secret on turn one, Gaara would have just been saying, like, is this like a Reno Paladin? What am I playing
What's
against
going
here?
On?
Is this mid-range?
Is there like any fin happening here?
Oh, no, that's... We haven't actually, so that's kind of an interesting point. We haven't seen any fins, and we haven't seen Reno in general at all. So this has kind of been a tournament where I would have expected some of these decks to be a little more popular. Mm-hmm. Didn't see them at all today.
I think that one of the decks that players suspected would be among the most popular is Midrange Druid. And I do think that Midrange Druid is particularly punishing against a lot of those late game, more combo-oriented decks. So I think that may be why we're seeing many more players choosing to play the aggressive style of Warlock deck rather than something like Reno Lock or like the Malygos combo decks.
Yeah, the aggressive Warlock is definitely a great choice against Druids. So if you're expecting to see a lot of Druids, why not go with that? But I certainly expected to see more Reno, but all we've seen so far have been those Zoos.
All right, so we're going to hop right in here. We're going to see Gaara bring out that Hunter, which we talked about as a class. It's a little bit on the weaker side of the spectrum now for probably the first time since really Unleash the Hounds became popular way back in the day. Yep. Against Casper's Secret Paladin again. And we see Ragnaros. That is a card that has recently started being added to Secret Paladin to kind of give it that little bit of extra go. In the end?
I have gotten killed by so many Ragnaroses out of Secret Paladin. I'm like, okay, I'll Frost Nova your board, and then, oh, no.
Frost Nova? Were you playing Freeze Mage, Brian?
No, I was playing Monkey Mage. Come on, man.
Oh, sorry. I'm not up to date on those all those happening techs you kids are running, but no, that makes a lot of sense. And Ragnaros definitely gives the Secret Paladin a little bit of an extra punch at the end of the game. And there was kind of a surprise factor to it at first. You're like, all right, I have survived the Challenger.
Yeah.
I have defeated Dr. Boom. I have put Tyrion in his grave and broken the weapon. I win this game. And then the Ragnaros just slams down.
It's
You're
like, oh, no.
Oh.
I thought I had fought through everything.
No. There's more. And so Gaara has Hunter's Mark in the opening hand, and we see the Lothab as well, which pretty clearly telegraphs at the very least it's not that hyper-aggressive face variant. And yeah, this is mid-range.
That is an unexciting opening hand from Gaara there. Hunter Creeper's a nice pickup there. That's one of the better cards he could hope to draw at this point.
Conversely, Casper has gotten a little bit of a friendlier hand.
Yeah, double yes. Secret Keepers. This is completely different than what he had in the previous game. That's as good as it gets with the coin. Noble Sacrifice, interestingly, he chose to keep it in the starting hand. I think it is like it's a fine card to have early on. Trades well with a lot of the Hunter minions, but personally, I don't like keeping it that much because you always have the risk of drawing a second one.
He did have the Secret Keeper, which does obviously pair well with some of the cheap secrets here. And I like his decision here just to play the Secret Keeper turn one. Some players may try and go for a really fancy, I want to get as big Secret Keeper as possible, but he only has the one secret anyway, so his next turn can just be Secret Keeper into secret, and then he's in, oh, there's the other secret though.
Yeah. Oh,
but he
my
still
goodness.
Has Dr. Boom and Mysterious Challenge in his hand, so I would not expect him to use his coin here to just make two big Secret Keepers, though I imagine Ghosts do have a close relationship with Undertakers, which is what this could end up looking like.
I actually kind of would like it. It's a little bit of an all-in play because he doesn't have a play for next turn, and then he also wouldn't have the coin anymore for the Mysterious Challenger. But Gaara could potentially have an Eaglehorn Bow or something. Mm-hmm. That would help dealing with those three toughness Secret Keepers.
I was going to say Undertaker. That's a name I haven't heard in quite some time. Now, obviously, there was a really popular community video just recently where a guy took a bunch of the in-game sounds and made a music video about it. And there was one where Secret Paladin was talking about the perfect curve to the theme of Aladdin. It was really good. But actually looking over at Gaara, despite having a kind of awkward hand based on the draw, he's drawn into Haunted Creeper. He's got Animal Companion. He's a five drop away from having that perfect curve.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Gaara definitely, after the rough-looking starting hand, he did pick up exactly what he needed in that two and three drops.
Although, we'll say, that one secret comes down. You've got two, three Secret Keepers. This is suddenly for Gaara, it's one of those really, really testing situations where you're like, is it Noble Sacrifice? If this Animal Companion is Hover, or do you maybe just, it might even be better to Quickshot, but then is it Avenge?
The quick shot's a little bit awkward because he would love to be able to potentially play two things next turn. Like, he could potentially play Quickshot and Freezing Trap next turn, but he is running the risk, if he tries to play that way, that he may just run into a additional secrets from his opponent.
Always suffer.
So now Gaara has to be thinking, okay, what am I trying to play around here as far as the secrets go? If he's trying to play around Noble Sacrifice, then maybe he just sends his spider to the face first. If he's trying to play around Revenge, well, maybe he just sends his spider to the face first.
Yeah, I don't think there's any downside, really, like, from attacking with the creeper to face first.
I wonder.
Like, I think that you really don't want to run into Avenge. Like, if you avenge one of these here, I guess you do have Freezing Trap, but it seems against either secret, attacking first with your 1-2 is probably the best option. Mm-hmm. But Gaara's taking his time to evaluate.
Oh, these are the kind of turns that absolutely keep me up at night. Because, like, obviously, all right, you're going to test for the Noble Sacrifice, and sure, great. Huffer isn't getting thrown into a Noble Sacrifice. You still probably have to trade Huffer into a one-mana Secret Keeper.
Oh, no, he did not. He just went face.
Respect, Gaara. Respect. Don't let those Secret Keepers intimidate you. Oh. You're the hunter here.
Oh, look at that.
Oh, this turn.
Oh, the punish.
Perfect draw.
Speaking of the perfect curve, here's a Cog Hammer.
Right. If we see a Shredder in the next turn, we'll know. But yeah, this Coghammer is going to do so much work, and Huffer, I obviously respect Gaara going face. That was probably the correct play, because that's just 4 damage to the face you got to get, but unfortunately, Huffer gets traded out very, very conveniently, and ooh, a little bit rough time to be the hunter, because once you get to this point, it's hard to battle back on board.
It's true. I mean, Gaara has a reasonable play this turn if he wants to take it with the quick shot into Freezing Trap to kill one of the Secret Keepers and leave the other one potentially stuck. But again, he's using all these resources to deal with one drops, and he isn't actually able to develop any real board presence himself. Here he's just hoping that there's no more secrets
right.
on the other side. But unfortunately for him, that Avenge represents that one drop killing his 4-drop, and then we'll likely see, I imagine, the mini bot come down as well.
So this is interesting because when Seeker Paladin first became popular, a lot of players were playing Face Hunter because they muster, you unleash, you go face, you do not trade. It was like the one matchup where you just legitimately never traded except for Knife Juggler. Mid-range Hunter has a tragically hard time against Seeker Paladin because you just get battled off the board, and mid-range Paladin or mid-range Hunter is all about having that board, right?
Yes.
Building up to that high main, getting the Houndmaster that makes like the Haunted Creeper really big. And so unfortunately, Gaara is kind of in a situation now where it's like, how do you actually get back on the board?
Yeah, the big problem for him here is those Secret Keepers gave Casper such an early advantage in terms of just presence. And now, you know, Gaara, he has some powerful cards in his hand, but he doesn't have time. He has the high main, he has the Freezing Trap, but...
That's Jillwind Yeti status now on the
Secret Keeper. Yeah, that is a scary, scary Secret Keeper at this point.
So I'm sure Gaara knew what he was doing, that was going to become a 4-5. I do this all the time on ladder, and I never know.
It's funny, I always forget.
Yeah.
I somehow managed to always be like, oh yeah, that buffs your guy too.
I'm like, mirror entity, good. Oh no, 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 no. Right, and we're going to see that the old coin mysterious challenger.
I think this is worth a perfect curve song, I think. You know? we've seen the second challenger and Dr. Boom waiting in Casper's hand.
We did not see a value muster though. Knife Juggler into value muster. The lyrics of the song,
it's
Brian
true.
Say.
And it's and top deck Shredder.
Right.
It's important.
And then coin challenger. We did see the coin challenger though, that's good. And he got two Secret Keepers. So close enough. Give it a B+.
In this particular instance, I actually think his draw may have worked out better.
No, I don't know if it's going to happen, but we could very much see a Secret Keeper trade for the first part of the Savannah High Main. What a dark time to be around.
I just think we're going to see Secret Keeper go face. There's no reason for him to attack. It actually, if anything, actually gives Gaara additional bodies to potentially break a Noble Sacrifice, then attack something else. I mean, there's a face there. Let's hit it.
Pushing his opponent down to 7 HP at this point. In combination with the weapon, any of those three minions would be lethal.
We see a really quick Unleash the Hounds. I kind of wonder if this is maybe Gaara's way of conceding, because I'm not really sure I see a way for him to clear this board. We know he has a Hunter's Mark in here, but it obviously hasn't surfaced, and I'm not even sure getting rid of one of these things with Hunter's Mark would really make that much of a difference.
Get down!
Yeah, this is just pretty out of hand for Gaara at this point. I think maybe he's just, you know, seeing if there's any weird secrets in Casper's deck, perhaps.
Yeah, I mean, the Paladin is going to be out anyway, so that isn't even like that useful. I guess if there was something really weird in the deck, he could kind of expect weird things from the other decks too.
I mean, you can gain some sort of information about the kind of decisions that your opponent might make in their deck building
right.
Across the board. But here, I mean, Gaara has a bunch of damage, but the opposing face is a little too healthy to really get much done. And there, Gaara concedes, so we are going to be at an even score of 1-1 in this match.
Right, and that's very much one of those situations where Secret Paladin kind of has this reputation of being this mechanical deck that you just kind of like, it plays itself a little bit. And, you know, to a lesser extent, honestly, that game, Casper, you know, the cards were laid out before him. He didn't have to do too much. He's like, I'm on turn 5. I have this coin, and I have this Mysterious Challenger. Yeah. What should I do? And obviously, he made the right call into the second Mysterious Challenger. We even saw Dr. Boom in the end, so Gaara had a bad matchup there.
But I think there was some decision-making in the Paladin, right, still, like keeping the coin that long. Some people might have maybe coin out a second Secret Keeper on turn 1, and that would have not been as good.
Yeah, I mean, we saw, I think, in a lot of ways, the many-faceted power of the Secret Paladin deck there. You know, it's a very powerful sort of mid-range deck in a lot of cases, but we saw it get very much out-tempoed, very much out-tempo the mid-range Hunter deck, just with getting those early Secret Keepers, which grew to enormous size and really kept Gaara on the back foot all game.
Right, and Houndmaster, we kind of saw the weakness of that card right there, and really, I think that's actually the Achilles heel of mid-range Hunter versus Secret Paladin. Houndmaster, if it can come out and you can get it on that Haunted Creeper, great. You can get it on something like Leok, super powerful card. But when you're in that situation where we saw Gaara's best play there was to play down the Houndmaster and hope there wasn't a Secret in the end. And I mean, yeah, maybe you expect the Secret to come out earlier if it had been there, but obviously, Casper had it. He plays it down.
I mean, Gaara did take a pretty aggressive line, just going face with that Huffer as well.
Right.
I mean, it's possible that maybe the game plays out a little differently if he chooses to clear one of those Secret Keepers rather than attack face with the Huffer, because he ended up, you know, doing some damage there, but ultimately ended up facing down two huge Secret Keepers in the end.
That's definitely the sort of play you make when you're playing the face Hunter, right? Because you're just,
right,
I have to go and I have to get that damage now. But mid-range Hunter lacks that bursty follow-up, so it's one of those things like, all right, I Huffered face, now I have a Houndmaster, no beast on the board. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, yeah.
On the other hand, Casper did pick up the Coghammer from the top, and if he didn't have that card in that moment, the situation would have been different. Yeah. The Huffer attack to face would have worked out better.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, he ended that game, Casper ended that game at, I think, 25, and that would have been a little bit different if he hadn't had a taunt with Divine Shield that turn.
Right, we would have definitely seen one of those Secret Keepers be traded into the Huffer, and then we probably would have seen another Secret Keeper trade into one of the 1-1s on the board, the Spiders. But yeah, Gaara went with the line that he thought would win him the game. He kind of thought to himself, all right, I can't really sustain a long-term fight with a Secret Paladin. He's already had a really strong start. If more stuff comes down, there's no way I'm going to ever get bored. Just decides to go face. Didn't pan out for him, but fully expect to see Gaara kind of recover. Obviously, it's a tied series, so now it's just basically best of three.
Yep. And if that Paladin was something that was giving Gaara a lot of trouble, at least it's out of the way now.
Yep. So we're going to see Gaara stick with the Hunter, and we are going to see Casper playing a Warlock. Now, this appears more to be something in the vein of Reno Lock or
Reno Lock. There's a Dark Bomb in the hand, which is a card you don't typically see, similar with Mortal Coil in the more aggressive Warlock decks. So this is going to be a little bit different than some of the matchups we've seen earlier.
Yeah, we have not seen any Dark Bombs from the Warlock decks that we've seen earlier today.
Now, I'm actually not a huge fan of playing stuff like Reno Lock or combo Reno Lock. In Power Overwhelming, is that specifically restricted to combo Reno Lock, or is that something you tend to see more?
Oh, wow. Did Gaara actually give a freezing drop?
I believe Gaara kept his entire hand.
Well, he kept the freezing drop. That's really interesting.
That is, yeah, that's an unusual choice.
But if he draws another one, it's a little bit risky. It might work out. I'm really interested to see.
I was also kind of wondering what other secrets he's running, right? Because we only ever saw the freezing trap. We didn't see an explosive trap or a bear trap, which has become somewhat popular. It's combo, we know
now.
So the Leroy Jenkins signifies that he's probably playing the combo version of Reno Lock, which is a very popular deck recently that uses the Emperor Tharisin in combination with Leroy Jenkins, Power Overwhelming, and Faceless Manipulator to do a huge burst of damage in a single turn.
Right, no, it definitely, kind of creates a strategy wherein you are looking to finish off your opponent with a good amount of burst damage through the use of Faceless Manipulator.
Upwards of 20 damage.
Sometimes more. You know, sometimes more if you have stuff on the board, but yeah, that's definitely something that once it gets going is really powerful. It's super good against other control decks.
Oh yeah, absolutely. You have so much reach with that combo.
And the Reno element of the deck, along with some of the more kind of handlock style elements, can give it powerful tools against aggressive decks as well. The ability to regain a lot of lost health with Reno can be a huge deal in the mid game.
And then we see
it is always Huffer. You were right.
Yeah.
We'll see if the third one, if Gaara is just Huffer Master, but Traditionally, mid-range Hunter had an extremely difficult time dealing, or mid-range Hunter was extremely favored against the old version of Handlock. Obviously, this is a totally different deck. Do you guys have any experience with this matchup or any kind of insight into generally who's more favored in this one?
It's a pretty high variance matchup. The Reno Lock deck, naturally speaking, given that it's all singletons, will often live and die based on what it draws. And we just saw Casper draw that Reno, which can be a huge deal. Though the Reno is less of a factor, or at least less of a big deal against the mid-range versions than it is against the more aggressive face versions.
Wow.
And it is, in fact, always Huffer.
Three of a kind for Gaara. Knows what he wants.
It's actually, it's possible that this game could actually end before... Ooh, no, he chooses not to attack. Does not want to enable Molten Giant. And that's actually an interesting decision because the more Molten Giant focused Handlock decks have actually fallen kind of out of favor.
Right.
And now it's possible that missed damage from the Mad Scientist not attacking could end up being a major factor in this game.
Well, when we look there, we see the Houndmaster would have added 2 damage, so he would be at 10 right now, mm-hmm. and then we would see 8, so it would have been at 2.
And then the Reno comes,
so ultimately it won't end up being a factor in the way that this game will specifically play out.
Right, but it does play better around the Molten Giant, mm-hmm. so interesting decision from Gaara. I'm sure there could be a lot of discussion on whether or not that's the technical most correct line of play, mm-hmm. but we obviously see what he was trying to do there.
Yes, absolutely. The idea of not attacking there is to prevent his opponent from playing Molten Giant for free, and thus being able to play multiple Molten Giants and taunt them up at the same time.
Right, so you would have seen like the Sun Fury, something like that.
Well,
while
we know that this is a Reno Lock deck, Gaara doesn't have the luxury of seeing the hand as he's playing the game.
That's a misplay. Why wouldn't you just look at your opponent's hand while you're playing? It's ridiculous to me. Some people.
The decision whether or not to go for face is often based on whether or not you have follow-up damage to go with it. For example, if you had a Kill Command and a Quick Shot, then it's much easier to just go for face and not care about the Molten that much.
All right, we see the first Reno. Yeah, there's a little Reno Murloc behind us. We saw the first Reno on stream, at least, and Gaara accepts it, kind of probably figured, you know, at some point this was going to happen, and he just puts down the Savannah High Main, which is still incredibly difficult for the Warlock to remove.
And this freezing trap that Gaara has down is actually proving to be very valuable. It's prevented the Lotheb from trading into the Huffer that turn. Huffer was able to kill Reno to prevent it from coming back with that freezing trap. But Dr. Boom gives a lot of power to the board here and the ability to easily clear off the freezing trap.
That Hunt is a great pickup for Gaara right there. Lets him deal with the Dr. Boom quite easily.
I was going to say, the only thing that would really make the situation better for Gaara, I think, is an Unleash.
Mm-hmm. Well, Unleash, he actually might even just win the game with an Unleash. Well, very close.
That would certainly be better than not having won the game.
So he has 12 damage in play if he were to attack everything at face right now. Kill Command another 5, so 17, 2 more, 19. So he's 5 off lethal if he just sent everything to Casper's face.
Right, and now, how much other healing is in this deck, John Roy? I'm sure there's one Healbot floating around.
Usually there's a Healbot. Probably, sometimes there's a Farseer or Refreshment Vendor. Those are always things you need to keep in mind. But generally speaking, Reno is the big problem.
Right, and you've already kind of been through that, and Gaara still has an incredibly intimidating board. I kind of like this play where you just go for it. You know you have the Kill Command in hand, and you have, obviously, your Hero Power, so we are going to see him at least trade out this. And this is fine. He's going to play that second high main. This board is still really difficult to deal with. And yeah, it's... So if he gets rid of one bomb can still be traded into the freezing trap, so realistically there's not a whole lot of reason to do it that way, I don't think.
It looks like he chose to trade off his larger minion rather than the Mad Scientist because he wants the Mad Scientist to give him his next freezing trap
when
his opponent is forced to trigger this freezing trap initially.
Right, it's those little things that ultimately add up. You know, having that second freezing trap there will prevent more damage to his board. And as long as that board stays intact, he's in a really good spot. Mm-hmm.
So freezing trap.
We talked about the other heals.
Casper shaking his head because the freezing trap actually gets returns the minion to the hand, and then Casper had a full hand of 10 cards. So the Boombot actually was destroyed, which incidentally might not even be worse for him.
Yeah, I'm trying to think, like, what's the problem here? Isn't that good for him?
He's shaking his head and emoting oops, but
why would he want a 3-mana Boombot?
Yeah, I actually think triggering the Boombot there and potentially killing off the Mad Scientist or something, you know, without having to use any resources might actually be better for him.
But it's probably one of those things where that wasn't his intention.
It's more a matter of him having a different plan and that plan not working out. Because he actually, after this Hellfire, he very well might just have played a 3-mana Boombot to follow this up.
Mm-hmm. Alright, so this will be a full board clear, but his health is going to be really low.
Yeah, and Gaara already with one kill command in his hand.
Right, so I'm going to see. Ooh.
Unleash. Okay.
Not useful this turn.
Yeah, a little less good than it would have been last turn, but it does generate a cheap beast, which is important for being able to deal the damage with kill command.
Right. And I like the fact that Gaara obviously has given up on trying to play around Molten Giants at all. He's pretty much completely understands what this deck is now. He's seen the Reno. He figures if there is a Molten Giant, it's going to be one at the very worst. So he's just like, nope, it's time to go now. I'm going to lose this late. I just need to go ahead and kill him.
Absolutely. There's no way Gaara can afford to try to play around the Molten anymore.
Right now, Casper has a bunch of cards in hand. We were talking about the heals he has. Siphon Soul does heal for three. So there is that. We haven't seen a Healbot yet or that Earthen Ring Farseer you mentioned. So no Jiraxxus either just yet, which, I mean, bringing it up to 15 against Midrange Hunter is actually a big deal, especially once you've dealt with those high mains. Mm-hmm. That's a lot of the offensive potential of this deck.
Yeah, I mean, Gaara has been through most of his big minions so far, and he's going to be largely leaning on his hero power to get the rest of the job done.
All right, hero power is second kill command.
Quick shot. He had two quick shots we saw in the previous game.
Right. So you can drop down a Mind Control tech just to tempo it out, or just that Zombie Chow again. Obviously wants to hold on for the Swamp Ooze. That could prove pretty big against Eagle Horn, though.
So not quite enough, I think. Kill Command Unleash is 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Oh, did he have enough mana? No, he's actually mana short.
Right, so
if he had 10 mana, he could win the game this turn, but he's actually 1 mana or a bit of damage short.
Yep, seems like it.
Well, again, you have seen the Reno, so I think it's safe to just start pushing damage, right?
Mm-hmm. Every other heal that's left in this matchup is just a numerical heal, not a full heal. So, at worst, you're getting in a bit of damage here.
Right.
Even though Gaara doesn't have the lethal just yet, he's in an extremely comfortable spot at 27 HP. Even if his opponent is running the combo, no Emperor has been played yet.
It's also worth noting that he knows that his opponent's Lotheb is gone. So keeping a hand that relies on playing multiple spells to finish the opponent off with damage is not as risky as it would be if your opponent still had Lotheb left.
Right, you're no longer afraid. You know you can confidently chain those spells together on whatever turn you get it in. So Gaara is just going to get that damage, figure if there's any reason to play any of these other spells right now, and going to go for that quick shot. So obviously not going to draw a card because his hand is not empty, but he gets the damage now, and he's not really banking on needing to draw that card.
Yeah, here he's just like, I have the damage to finish my opponent off. I'm not going to need an extra card from quick shot. I want to be mana efficient in case my opponent does play something that can potentially stop me from being able to lethal him the next turn.
Right, something like that Healbot. And we see Twisting Nether in the hand of Casper. I think this is one of the coolest things about this deck, about Reno Lock in general, is that Twisting Nether is a card that is being run now. It's such a flashy animation.
I mostly like the animation. And
right.
I wish I had an excuse to play it more often, simply for the animation. My favorite thing is actually casting Twisting Nether with both Fugin and Stalag in play and getting two Thaddeuses after that animation, because basically there's just animations for days with the animation with both Thaddeuses.
I'm going to be honest and totally just make Chad cringe here, but I was really hoping that we would have someone from the Netherlands play Twisting Nether so that I could say Twisting Netherlands. But at this point, it looks like I'm not getting close to actually being able to do that, so I just want to point that out when I had
the chance. You just wasted it, though. You can't just throw in your contextual joke out of context. That's just not how it works. There are rules, Rob.
Fair point, Brian. Fair point.
But and now Casper is trying to set up a powerful future turn, but we know that Gaara has the tools to finish him off with this Unleash kill command. And there it is.
Yeah, potentially with that play, Casper could have set up lethal for next turn. Mm-hmm.
With the combo,
with those minions, but Gaara with the kill command is going
Ooh.
To be enough.
The spicy greetings, Traveler. And
gets a threaten back for his trouble.
But Casper kind of smiled. He understands it's all good fun, BM tastefully done. So there's a difference, right? You know, there's sometimes when you're on the ladder and that Warlock just spams, I will greet you, and that does not feel tasteful. It's not an exciting gameplay experience, but Gaara takes a lead now 2-1. He just needs to get one more win with that Paladin deck, and Paladin's a pretty strong class these days, so that's what feels good.
Sure is. We have seen Paladin have a lot of luck today. It's been a very strong deck that a lot of players have brought and had a lot of success with.
Right, and we haven't seen just yet if this is mid-range or any fin. Gaara is the sort of player
it's
I could
true.
See bringing any fin, so that's not outside of the realm of possibility, but As you said, with all the druids kind of running around, it doesn't feel like a super safe play. Mm. So it might just be that Secret Paladin we've kind of been seeing a lot today.
Another potential thing that Gaara could do is that maybe he is bringing a Secret Paladin, but has put his own twist into it, making some interesting deck choices, because that's something that he really likes to do.
Yeah, I've actually seen quite a few variations on the sort of basic Secret Paladin shell. I actually played against an Egg Paladin not long ago that had, you know, Nerubian Egg, which is clearly very good with...
Wow. Is it happening?
Oh god, there it is.
But the Warlock hand is
there's
not
there's no knife juggler, and he's not going to top deck his Shredder.
But that will probably be a value it buster. It's still value, even if you don't have the knife juggler.
Though, so this being the perfect curve we were discussing with the song earlier.
We really want to sing the song. I don't think you understand at home how much we want to sing the song.
Oh, but he mulliganed the girl. He can't summon this girl.
No, it's not going to happen. He does get an Alder Peacekeeper, so not necessarily a super interesting twist, but that is a card that we haven't seen too much of, especially with Keeper of Aldemon out.
Abusive Sergeant is not a card we've actually seen very much of in Secret Paladin deck, however.
All right, there we go. There's the Gaara twist.
Yeah,
we
that's the Gaara twist.
The old Gaara twist, the dance move everybody loves.
Alder Peacekeeper, Abusive Sergeant. Such a powerful hand, but Casper with
This is interesting. Casper's actually choosing to attack face here, rather than attack to kill the shield on the mini-bot. And the Abusive Sergeant will actually allow him to kill the Chao with just the Divine Shield.
Yeah. Right.
Which is actually very relevant. You know, it'll keep the body of the mini-bot in play. And I imagine because you rarely see cards like Abusive Sergeant, that's not really a play you necessarily think about. But Gaara's just going to go with making a Silverhand Recruit this turn.
I mean, the Abusive would have been a little bit inefficient with the mana, I suppose.
It's true.
Still gonna be good here. He can now use it with the mini bot to take out the Imp Gang boss if he wants to. Mm-hmm.
It is also inefficient on his mana though.
It's true.
He would love to I think play Muster this turn potentially, though that does set up right into the Demon Wrath that we see in Casper's hand.
Something I really like about Rena Lock that is interesting to me is the way it curves out, and because you have this variety of cards, it's totally possible to play on a curve that's almost Zoo-like, right?
Yeah.
Obviously, Zombie Chao, not a card we see in Zoo. I think we did very, very briefly, just not popular in that. But, you know, having the ability to play all these kind of, like, low mana creatures, we see the Twilight Drake out now. That's big. There's Defender of Argus. So it's not just all late game option, whereas Handlock was traditionally a little bit clunky in that you really didn't get going until later than turn four. So we see the Implosion, which is very much Zoo-like.
Yeah, this is a very strong proactive board from Casper here. He now has solid control of this board with five minions to Gaara's zero.
Yeah, such a strange game. Just looking at the starting hands, it looked like Gaara had everything, but somehow he ended up hero powering on turn two and three. And now Casper with the board.
Right, so we see there in his hand, we have the Consecration. We have the Piloted Shredder. Mm-hmm. So I think this is an interesting turn because obviously when you look at this, if this was a ladder game, you're like, a board full of things with sub two health, Consecration kills them all. If you play down that Piloted Shredder, maybe you're hoping that it just trades into a lot of the minions anyway, and then you don't have to do the Consecration, but you could also look at something like Muster, make your own board, and then kind of hope that you're thinking, okay, Hellfire clears the whole board, you're not going to use a Shadow Flame, and then you're basically only afraid of Demon Wrath.
Yeah, I don't know if the Consecration can get any better than this.
That's Consecration against a typical Zoo deck will generally retain value late in the game because your opponent is playing lots of small minions. But against a Reno Lock style of deck, you're rarely going to find a board state where Consecration is going to be great, and this is a case where it is.
Gaara here just has to win one more game. This is the round of 32 again, so after he wins this, he not only secures a spot to day two, to that top 16, he will in fact secure some portion of the $100,000 prize pool that is awarded for the Europe Winter Championship.
Yeah, so I mean, we saw him take, you know, very much pretty much the full time there on the rope last turn. Understandable when you're playing, you know, not only for guaranteed money, but also the chance to continue to play into the championship next month.
That was quite a bit of money, too. It was like 2,500 immediately, so.
Right, and like I said, you get to keep going tomorrow, so that feels pretty good. Yeah. An honest day's work where you make 2,500 bucks and you get to go to day two and
not
fight
bad.
For an opportunity to go to the championship.
A little bit of a rough draw there with the redemption.
Yeah, not what he was hoping for, though. It will potentially still have value in future turns, just won't give him the same power on this turn. But Casper's thought, he doesn't know which secret isn't there.
Right.
He knows that three secrets came down. That's unusual. So you have to figure out, okay, well, what are the implications of any particular secret being missing? you got to imagine that the most likely secrets to be missing are the ones there are single copies of in the deck.
Right. Yeah.
So it is likely either Redemption or Competitive Spirit if you're if you're coming out from his perspective.
Like in this type of situation, you can pretty much guess that it's going to be a Noble Sacrifice and an Avenge, but you have to just guess what the third one is. Mm-hmm.
Right. And this is kind of the interesting thing about playing Secret Paladin, where you start like trying to basically disarm the bomb. You're like trying to figure out which wires to cut. You're like, cut the yellow one. They're all yellow, right? But as you said, the one-off copies, stuff like Competitive Spirit, stuff like Redemption, that's usually where your head's going when you don't see the fourth secret. Or even, I mean, we've seen Repentance actually today. It's still one that people sneak in there, especially in tournament, it feels like. But Dr. Boom, pretty solid turn 7, and it was Competitive Spirit that was down. So this represents a lot of damage on the board, not enough for lethal, though.
It's very close.
Yeah.
It's very close, yeah.
There's already 14 damage there, but Gaara has to be respecting the possibility of Reno.
Right.
Because if he does decide to use so many of his resources to push the face, then Casper will potentially be able to just punish him with Reno Jackson. So fighting for board here is likely, I imagine, what he's going to be trying to do. The problem there is that he doesn't, other than trading two minions into Dr. Boom, eating the Twilight Drake, there's not a great option for him there. And if he does that, he doesn't really get any damage in either.
I really like this play from Casper, because when you drop that Dr. Boom on 7 and you don't do anything to deal with the board, what that says to me, that telegraphs that you have Reno. Because you're unafraid of taking that damage. Mm-hmm. Now we see he does have tools. He has Defender of Argus, he has Shadow Flame, he has a lot. But I would assume that what you were saying, you automatically, your brain goes to that possibility of Reno Jackson.
No, that's true. So this is a little bit of a bluff here. Gar might be leaning towards trading. There is
He did not attack with the Peacekeeper first.
That's a little bit rough.
A lot of damage missed out.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised by that decision from Gaara to attack into the bot first. And he got absolutely punished by that sequencing.
Casper was just smiling. He's like, good job, Boombots. You did exactly what I needed you to do.
And now he has a lot of options here. He could get a full clear with the Shadow Flame. Demon Rod would kill everything except for the Mysterious Challenger.
Ooh, if you're Gaara right now and you see that targeting reticule hovering over the face, I think you know what's about to happen, and it's about to feel really bad.
Yeah, it's kind of like the same thing as against the Warrior. When you see them go face in situations like this, it's always a brawl.
Yeah. Oh, and this is one of those things, too. Shadow Flame is probably the card that is just most upsetting when I'm on ladder, and I just see him like, no.
Well, this actually ended up going relatively well for Gaara as far as where the Avenge landed, because the Avenge landed on one of the smaller minions. Even just Demon Wrath could have been a potential very close to a clear, at least.
Okay, this is a good draw, given what's in your hand.
Yeah.
You get the 4/5. You pay one mana for a 4/5.
But what Gaara really needs right now is the Divine Favor.
Yes. Yeah. I don't know. We haven't seen Divine Favor in his deck. We did see a couple more mid-range elements like that Peacekeeper, which would tend to perhaps be included in decks that don't have Divine Favor. But now, Gaara is suddenly in a lot of trouble with an empty hand against nearly full hand of cards from Casper.
Divine Favor is also one of those cards where it feels like people who play a lot of Sacred Paladin are very much like torn on whether or not you include the one of it. Do you just put something in like the Abusive Sergeant, which we've seen that does a better job fighting for the board, does a better job pushing damage. Maybe you just are banking on like, if I get this point on cards, I'm not going to win.
Right. The Divine Favor is really like a hit or miss. You can actually, in some matchups like against the Freeze Mage, you are guaranteed to get amazing value and you can win the game because of that. But it's not that great always.
Speaking of not that great, Keeper of Oldemon is a very solid card on its own. But at this point, you're kind of in a situation where you're on one card, and you can see Gaara
literally he's literally face-palming. His head is in his hand.
Just this is not the draw, because even if you are able to trade out the Thorazan, the damage is done. Thorazan has probably in your head done what it needs to do, and then you're not pushing damage. You continue to play a race against an opponent who will frankly beat you at some point with this combo.
Yeah, if you're in Gaara's position here, I don't think you have an option except to go face. There's no way that you're winning a long attrition game at this point. Not only are you playing against a Warlock, but you're playing against a Warlock with a full hand and who has discounted a bunch of the cards.
Yeah.
He decides with a different attack, just attacks for one, clears off the Emperor.
Now we haven't seen, this is the first time that Gaara is playing his Paladin, so we don't quite know what else is in the deck, so maybe there is more late game than
possible.
We expect.
I mean, he could have something like a Ragnaros, he could have
right,
a Divine Favor.
Did we not see that?
Into.
Or was that was
Ragnaros
that
is the last match, I believe. I believe Casper had the Ragnaros.
Right, so something else to consider. We saw Gaara throw down Noble Sacrifice, so if you are banking on surviving the combo, That is one thing that can help you, is a noble sacrifice.
It's true.
Again, Casper has no minions on board, so that could be something that Garo was considering, that you just don't want it to proc the noble sacrifice, and then you are maybe hoping to draw into what Savis was saying, a late game option that we haven't seen just yet.
Right.
And mind control tech takes one of the small ones, so that's a bit of fortune in Garo's favor here. And now Casper, I mean, he does have to be worried here about what, you know, what Garo can do in his future turns. Looks like he's choosing the Dark Bomb.
Yeah, potentially a Siphon Souling the Keeper if the Avenge lands on it.
All right. Oh,
so that's really not somewhere you want that to go if you're Garo.
No, you're definitely looking for the to try and spread out your threats as much as possible in this position.
Looks like it's not siphoning just yet. Maybe saving it for something like a Therion Forging.
Just building a big board. I mean, you had the mind control tech. You definitely don't expect a Garo to have it as a Secret Paladin player. So.
Yep. Coghammer is actually quite strong here. It's not necessarily going to be good enough, but Garo could, if he chooses, trade in both of his small minions and then play the Coghammer,
right?
Which will guarantee the Divine Shield and taunt on the 6-6.
Yeah, so you can do a little bit to try to soften up this board a bit, but you're continuing to get farther and farther behind. The Warlock Hero Power means it's going to get the cards, and we see what combo, quite as day, in Casper's hand. So right now, Garo's just playing it. I mean, this is, again, you're in round of 32. If you can win this game and just go to top 16, you absolutely have to try it. So whereas maybe, again, on ladder, this might have been a game that you were just kind of like, all right. I'm
Yeah, just finding the button from the top right corner. But, but with so much on the line in this match, there's no way we're going to see an early concede.
Right, so going to go ahead and see that Siphon Soul come out. That's great. You know, Garo got value off of it, but again, Casper just has so much on the board. Throws down a Shredder, and he's going to be able to pop the Noble Sacrifice here. Mm-hmm. And that means that combo is just free game, and we actually see enough damage represented on board to basically end the game next turn with combo.
And that is Muster for Battle. Great card, not great here. Garo is just attacking his face. I mean, he wants to get a little bit of value out of that Coghammer before he throws it away with the Muster, replacing it with Light's Justice. But we see the end is nigh in Casper's hand here with Leroy Jenkins, buffed with Power Overwhelming, Face Manipulator copying it, and that is it.
Just enjoy watching Leroy Jenkins do his job. Yeah. What a satisfying card.
It's pretty fun.
Don't even need that Power Overwhelming. Double Leroy, got double vision.
Yeah.
That's enough. And so Casper's going to tie up the series. For Garo, still another chance to win this. But you have to think both players now. This is those big game fives where, you know, you're not in the earlier rounds where it's one of those things where it's disappointing if you lose, but you kind of like go on with your life. Whereas where you're at this point and you can secure your spot in the next day, these are the really tense matches. Speeds, I know in your time you've competed in a lot of tournaments as well as you, Brian. So when you get to this point, is there, you like had to check, you're like, oh, Brian, yep, he did. But is there any extra stress that goes with these matches?
Absolutely. I mean, there was a point in my competitive gaming career where I would just constantly choke in late matches because as soon as, you know, I would let this sort of stress get to me. And then as soon as I would be in a position where I would lose a big match, then it would my mental state would just fall apart and it would just be all downhill from there. So when you really are sort of thinking about something like, okay, I just need to win this to make the top 16 to make money, you can easily get yourself out of the focused state that you really need to be in to play the game at your best.
Yeah, I think that even for experienced players, sometimes it can hit you pretty hard. You think about, okay, 2,500, potentially getting to top 8, getting to the live finals, or nothing. I mean, it can get to you. And
or go home.
It is worth noting that this tournament is double elimination. These players are in the winner's bracket, and if they lose, they still have a chance to advance. It'll just take them quite a few more matches.
Mm-hmm. All right, so this final match is going to be mid-range Druid versus Secret Paladin. This is a matchup that can honestly just go either way. There is no hard favorite in this one. Druid is thought of as a class that contends decently with Secret Paladin because you tend to have big game hunter. You have the swipes, which is really good against the Muster for Battle, but Secret Paladin can really just ramp up quickly. And we see Garo's opening hand, and he still has to consider his mulligans. Okay, he's going to throw back the one secret, and he has a pretty solid hand.
Yeah.
Keeper of Ultiman is fantastic for dealing with Innervate. It's fantastic for dealing with Wild
Keeper.
Growth.
Keeper is a very strong card against a deck like Druid that does play large minions ahead of schedule. I was saying earlier that I think that Keeper of Ultiman is one of the cards that has really cemented Secret Paladin as one of the top decks because it takes away a lot of the things that it used to be weak to. If your opponent, say, innervated out Druid of the Claw or coined out Druid of the Claw, as we may very well see next turn, previously that was a big deal. You didn't have any great ways to necessarily get through that big minion. But with Keeper of Ulduman, you can remove that much more easily than you could in the past.
Yeah, Keeper of Ulduman is just so flexible. You can either just play it on curve, play it as a Dude Master, +2/+2, go face immediately, or just using it to remove a threat from your opponent.
Be like 1/16th Master, you know, get like one of your guys, he's buffed like a quartermaster.
Writing that name down, Dude Master, I like that. That's good when someone called Snake Trap, Dude Trap. No, but we see here things are curving out pretty decently for Gaara, and if you're the Druid, this is one of those awkward situations where you don't really want the 1/1s on the board, but do you just coin out the Druid of the Claw, or do you just go for the swipe? There's options, but just swiping feels generally bad because you're not putting something on the board. You're basically allowing the Secret Paladin to go with whatever it's next on its agenda.
Yeah, it's kind of awkward to swipe because it's not even a full clear. There will still be those 1/1s remaining afterwards, so I'm kind of liking the Druid of the Claw, even though it does make the next turn a little bit bad, potentially.
It's actually, Gaara has a couple of strong options here.
Right.
Either a Keeper or a Blessing of Kings allows him to break through this Druid of the Claw right now. The Blessing of Kings, you could possibly Kings the Spider, and then even if there were a swipe to come down, he would only be able to kill the Spider and leave the others behind. I actually prefer Keeper of Ulduman here, because you can Keeper of Ulduman the Bear, trade in two of your guys and attack with your face. It leaves you with three minions in play and a board that's actually still resilient to swipe.
It's pretty good, and he also has two of the Keepers right now in his hand, so he will have more options going forward with one Keeper and the Kings.
Yeah, it looks like that's what Gaara does decide to go with. And we will see the face and I imagine two soldiers go in. This does remove some of the power of swipe against his board as well, because he's gotten value out of those one health minions that otherwise would just get, well, swept up by the swipe.
You're also putting him on the turn 5 swipe, which never feels good as a Druid player. You're floating that mana. You're not really building anything up, and he's going to go ahead and do it now before this board gets too out of control, but I really like where Gaara is sitting, actually, at the moment. Compared to Casper, who, you know, he got that Shade, he has the Ancient of Lore on turn 7, but, you know, a lot of it's that Savage Roar, probably not really going to be relevant until he's looking to close out the game.
Yeah, it's important for the Druid to be the one who is taking the initiative in this matchup, because it is so easy for the Paladin to continue to push an advantage that it might generate. And here we see the other mode of Keeper of Ulduman powering up that Spider, and now, you know, Gaara's getting in some damage and establishing a strong board that's difficult for Casper to deal with right before playing a Challenger next turn.
There is actually a full clear available here for Casper. He can rot the Spider first and then swipe the Keeper of Ulduman. That secret could be something else which would prevent him from getting the clear, but as it is a competitive spirit, so it's pretty clean.
Yeah, so I mean, Casper, from that position, pretty much the best he could hope for. He's able to actually wipe off the board, but Gaara does have Mysterious Challenger right on time.
Yep, and no answer from Casper's side right now.
Well, not necessarily an answer, but Dr. Boom is in essence an answer, because as a Druid, you're pushing more damage from hand because of Savage Roar, so it's kind of one of those things where, you know, Gaara's like, I can do this. What can you do? And Casper's like, well, I can do this. And Gaara's like, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
Ooh, that's actually a nice draw for Gaara there if he wants to try and set up, you know, a stronger board here. Getting multiple sticky minions in play when he does have four
he
damage there.
Trade now because of that boom, but
it's possible. Yeah, it's possible that now he would rather just send in the Mysterious Challenger to get Dr. Boom off the board. He has that second Noble Sacrifice in hand as well, so his ability to sort of defend himself from combo after he gets big creatures off the board is much higher than it might otherwise be.
Right, if he didn't have that Noble Sacrifice already played, he could have done something like Shield Minibot, Pilot the Shredder, and then second Sacrifice. As it stands, he's put down two incredibly resilient creatures, and it's kind of on the onus now to decide, if you're Casper, when are you just going to start turning on the damage? Mm-hmm. We see he can play down the Ancient of Lore. This isn't necessarily the greatest Thorsand turn, but it's not a bad one either. Like, obviously you would love to just have Force of Nature and Savage Roar. You already have Savage Roar, and the Shade of Naxxramas for 2 and Shredder for 3, that's pretty good.
It is, though. I imagine he has to be thinking that this game is not going to go that many more turns. So he may be trying to find more answers to possible threats that Gaara has right now. Like, for instance, that Keeper is an excellent pickup against Gaara, potentially going in with that Blessing of Kings. Both of his minions, and as well as an answer to a possible Avenge, which is something that obviously Gaara has in play from the Mysterious Challenger as well. And that's precisely why we saw Casper not attack with his Boombot here. He didn't want to trigger the Noble Sacrifice and thus trigger the Avenge and put himself on an even faster clock.
Right, and this, I think this is a very difficult turn for Gaara, because this is one of those turns where it's not clear as a Secret Paladin player, do you need to become more aggressive? Do you still have to trade out? I mean, you always have to respect the damage Druid can put out because of that combo. So he ends up making the value trade, gets rid of the Ancient of Lore. He still has a big board. And now he has three great targets for Keeper of the Grove. Not to mention
the event, which will generate an additional one.
Right. So if you are Casper, first thing you have to do, use that Boombot, proc the Avenge, and then figure out kind of from there where you want to go in terms of that Keeper, I suspect.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that seems like the way to go about this. Eventually, he will have to trigger those secrets, but I wouldn't be too surprised if he just chose to maybe not trigger those secrets and just play maybe Keeper of the Grove to silence the 6-6 and a Paladin Shredder.
I think Casper may be far enough behind that he kind of has to hope that Avenge lands on perhaps the 6-6.
Yeah.
Because if he just goes for the silence immediately and then Avenge lands on something else, like he could end up being in just too bad of a spot, but it looks like he's actually just not going to attack.
Okay.
He's going to try to just develop more of a board. And this is a play that makes quite a bit of sense. If you're choosing not to attack at all that turn, then you know you're putting Gaara on not really having that much that he can actually do. And here we see because of the lack of attack, yeah, those secrets are just dead cards in Gaara's hand.
Well, there's nothing Gaara can play right now. So considering Gaara's hand, not attacking worked out really well.
Yeah, then. I mean, and Gaara has to be really concerned about the possibility of him being the one who's about to die because of Force of Nature plus Savage Roar.
Right, and this, we said it before, and it's worth mentioning again, the problem with Secret Paladin is that sometimes it draws Paladin secrets. It doesn't necessarily just get him off the Mysterious Challenger. Mm-hmm. And as you guys said, Gaara literally cannot play anything
Let
from his hand.
Yeah.
The only thing he can do is proc the Hero Power, and Nightmare scenario, it hits the Boombot clears something, and it's just very scary to go face right now. And as you said, Force of Nature, Savage Roar, very strong right now, but there's also just double Savage Roar in hand, which represents a lot of damage.
Yeah, that's quite a bit of damage, too. See the juggle.
Nice, good juggler.
And now Gaara clearly calculating what.
Choke!
Oh my!
That's actually.
That is
a great.
That I think is fantastic Gaara. For Gaara.
Yeah.
Things you never expect to say. Yay! It's Lorewalker Cho.
Now Casper, if he forces your Savage Roar and it's not lethal, or plays any spell and it's not lethal, that's incredibly beneficial for Gaara.
What if game five of this comes down to Gaara the Paladin using double Savage Roar to kill the Druid player? That is cosmic justice if I ever heard it.
This can still go either way. Like just yeah, playing no, the Shade and the Emperor is quite powerful.
Yeah, I mean Gaara still if those secrets remain stranded in his hand, he has no way to advance his board. He doesn't have a particularly fast clock right now.
No.
So I actually agree with you. I think that the best play for Casper here is to just advance his own board and try to end the game in one fell swoop.
He would get double draws next turn for the Force of Nature.
Well, there's a card Gaara can play. Doesn't do very much, but at least he can play it.
Yeah.
I wonder if you're Casper, when you see those two hands, do you just think they're secrets? You're like, he hasn't played anything.
You have to be suspecting that they're secrets there. It's,
right.
It's the only thing that really makes sense given the way that the game is played out.
So this is another dangerous turn for Gaara, because you really just want to start pushing damage and just end this game, but you have to, again, respect the combo.
He has to get the minion off the board here and just go face. This is a really interesting game.
Force of Nature would do it.
Druid Claw, is that enough?
Well,
the face gets stopped.
12 from the roar.
And then you can double roar.
Yeah, so it's 12 plus. I think that's exactly lethal, actually.
It's 9.
Yes, because the minion.
Sorry. 12 plus 12. Yeah,
12
it is. You're
12.
Right. You're absolutely right. I believe Casper has exact lethal damage with this charged Druid of the Claw if he goes for it. That's something you're going to take your time to count this.
Yeah, absolutely.
No, I was going to say, I'm going to let you guys count this. That's my thing. So, but we see it is coming out here, and for Gaara, we will get to see Lorewalker Cho make this a very long kill.
And yeah, we see counting it up. That is going to be face going in. But there's enough left on the board. Noble Sacrifice blocks 4 damage. And then there is 24 from the 3 remaining minions.
Wow, what a way for this series to end. This was a crazy game.
That was an incredible conclusion to an incredible series, really.
It looked like Gaara was ahead for a long time there, but
I mean, the plays that Casper made, just choosing not to attack at all for several turns in a row, proved to be instrumental to his victory.
Right, and obviously he got some help from Gaara's deck in the form of just drawing those secrets. The Haunted Creeper, no Tyrion Insight, no Dr. Boom. Like, those high-pressure cards that Secret Paladin can have never got to them and just kept drawing the cards that are in your deck, which is unfortunately a lot of low-power cards in circumstances.
Yeah, I mean, that's the cost of playing Mysterious Challenge in your deck. The card is clearly very powerful, but in the instance that you draw one-cost Paladin secrets, they're not quite as powerful.
Right, so for Casper, this is a huge win, though, taking out Gaara, advancing to the top 16. He's going to get to go to day two now. Gaara's still in this. He still has a chance because this is double elimination, so definitely expect to see more from Gaara, and just great, great opportunity for Casper to really continue to put his mark on this, tournament.
I was really impressed by his play there, choosing to just hold back. I mean, we were talking about, well, he could do this. He might be in a really desperate spot, needs to do this. But he just calmly, just sat there with his Boombot. His Boombot was just hanging out for like three turns.
Yeah.
And then eventually, he was able to assemble a board that was enough to win the game in a single turn.
Yeah, we talked about it, how somebody might get nervous with so much on the line, but Casper didn't seem nervous at all. He was making solid plays throughout the series.
Right, and Druid, obviously, that's the class where if you just give it enough time, Druid is eventually going to find that damage, and you have to clear every turn all those minions, and Gaara is sitting in a place where the quality of his draws are not where he'd like them to be. So he has to, every single turn for the last three turns there, he's just sitting there like, all right, how much do I have to put into the board? Like, how much can I continue to pressure? Because, in the end, we saw, what was it, after the secrets, it was like four health after everything procced. For Casper. So it was an incredibly close series and absolutely hard fought. That last game especially was, you would not have expected it, but Secret Paladin versus Midrange Druid ended up being this very high IQ match. It was a real joy to watch and cast.
Yeah, it was great.
Yep.
So after this, obviously for Casper, top 16, not necessarily sure who Gaara is going to be playing next, and I believe we may have an interview coming up with Casper. I would love to hear from him. I think this is one of those players that we haven't necessarily heard of, and his name is his in-game handle is super difficult to kind of remember. If you're not really down on remembering sequences of letters and numbers, but I think people will remember at least the name Casper going forward after this match.
Yeah, certainly.
Looking forward to seeing him play on the next round. So I kind of knew from the ladder already that he's pretty good by that.
You were saying that you've run into quite a few times and that you definitely have some epic battles with him in the past.
Yeah. If you run into Zaviz a lot on the ladder, it's probably a good chance that you're a really good player. But we actually have Dan standing by with an interview.
Thank you very much, Rob, and congratulations to Casper as he is yet another player to put his name on the map and taking down another big player indeed. I believe he's joining me on the line, just talking a little bit about his experience so far, being able to come so far. Casper, can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Hello.
Awesome. How are you doing, man? How was that series for you? It looked pretty tense.
Well, when I started this match, I thought that I will lose because my lineup was really horrible to his. But I got pretty lucky, so I won.
Well, I mean, it's better to be lucky and good at the same time, right, in some of these scenarios. Can you talk a little bit about your background in Hearthstone, specifically of how you got to this point?
I know that I am a really unknown player. I was, actually. But I think that I'm pretty good. I know that I've made some misplays in this game. But yeah, it was stressful, probably.
Don't worry about it, man. Everyone makes mistakes. You're not the first person ever to misplay on stream. Don't worry. God knows I have as well. So let's go ahead and talk more about, maybe the path to getting to here. Were you playing primarily Cups online or on ladder, or were you through the Fireside Gathering? Can you talk about your journey to be able to get to this tournament specifically?
I got 10 points from ladder last season. I finished on place 13, I think. I also tried some online cups, but it didn't really work out to me.
Gotcha. So can you also talk a little bit about why you chose some of the decks that you did? For example, I think you're the first person on stream today to bring the Reno Warlock. Is there anything that inspired you, or is that just a deck that you really like, or do you feel like it was something that you wanted to counter a specific strategy? What was the reasoning behind it?
With the ban format, I really liked ban Druid, and I think Reno Lock is really good against other decks, except Druid. And as you can see, it works out.
Yeah, well, I mean, working out for you so far. And now that you're into the round of 16, do you feel like you're getting nervous? Or, I mean, how you seem pretty confident and sure of yourself in the chair, but now this is starting to become a reality. Is that affecting your play at all or your mindset?
We'll see. I guess I will try my best.
That's all you can ever ask for. Good luck, man. Do you have any final words before we send you off?
Follow me on Twitter, please. That's all.
Okay. This is an opportunity where you say your Twitter, because right now Twitter is kind of a big nebulous thing. I'll give you one more shot, man. Where can we follow you?
It's hashtag my nickname also A365 here.
I'll get right on that, man. I'm sure they all will, too. Congratulations, Casper. You're moving on to the next round. In the meantime, guys, we are going to get ready for our next match. We're still chugging along. We're about halfway, a little bit past halfway through. Make sure to let us know what you guys thought of that match as well. Tweet at PlayHearthstone or go to Hearthstone on Facebook. Coming up next, we're going to dip into the lower bracket matches for today. Next, we have Nyria from Team Liquid, also representing Ukraine, taking on a newcomer as well named Hallmark. When we come back, more action here at the Euro Preliminary. Stay tuned.